Good evening. Let's begin with singing Standing on the Promises. We need to trust those promises that we see in God's Word, in spite of the challenges that seem to contradict what we think God should be doing in our lives. Let's stand and sing the four verses. It's 445 if you need your hymn book.
Let's open in prayer. Father, thank you for your promises. That every promise that has been fulfilled, that down to the very word and timetable for the first coming of our Savior and the institution of the church and the mystery and the word of God that's been inspired and given to us. And Lord, and we know that the promises of the future that are still yet to be fulfilled. We can rest in those promises for a future hope, promises of peace for the nation of Israel, promises of bringing justice to this wicked and cruel world. Lord, promises to restore your people back to the promised land and to take us home and to fix this wicked, broken world, to restore creation back to praise and glory to your name. And that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And those are the promises that we can hold on to that will be fulfilled for us. And you've also given us a promise where two or three are gathered, you'll be in the midst of us. And you'll answer our prayer. You'll give encouragement. When we call out, you'll hear us and you'll answer us. And you're a friend that sticks closer than a brother. You've given us the promise that you will bring the Comforter to us, the Holy Spirit, who will come alongside and put his arm around us and encourage us through the difficulties that we go through, even this week. And Lord, you'll never leave us nor forsake us. Thank you for those promises that we hold on to. And Lord, I pray that you would encourage us tonight to be in the house of the Lord, to pray together, be with the young people's program, the children's program, the ESL class, those serving in the nursery, and those who can't be with us but are watching online. I pray that you would encourage them as they take part in the service from that way. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Welcome to our Wednesday night prayer and Bible study this evening. I want to just draw your attention to a couple announcements. Sunday morning, Sunday school will all be gathered together here in the auditorium at 9:30. Teens and up, ladies and gentlemen, Mark Herbster will be our speaker. He'll be preaching Sunday morning and the Sunday evening. We'll be taking a special love offering Sunday evening to help some of the travel expenses for Mark coming in for the men's retreat and also speaking. And so if you could be prepared Sunday evening, we will take a special offering for Brother Mark Herbster and his ministry here. Men's retreat on Friday, those of you that have signed up, even if you haven't signed up, there's still time this evening if you'd like to come out. We're planning, you can be there as early as 3 o'clock Friday afternoon. The very first thing that's kind of on our schedule is supper at 6, and then there'll be a session afterwards, and then we'll have a bonfire that evening. Nice, it's just right on the water, and we'll have a pontoon boat there between 3 and 6 in the afternoon on Friday if you want to take some boat rides. Looks like the weather's supposed to be really nice on Friday. And then Saturday, start at 8 o'clock with breakfast and a session after that. And then some time in the morning. And then we'll have a lunch and an afternoon, a session after lunch, and be done about 1 or 2 o'clock. And so that gives you a little bit of information about that. It's at the Marshall Baptist Camp, just on this side of Gunnersville. And so not too far on the outside of the city, but we have some information that was sent out in an email. So men, you'll come. And even if you didn't sign up, I know you want to come for the sessions. Some people are coming out Friday night and going back home and then driving back on Saturday morning. You're welcome to do that as well. We'll collect the money for the conference on the week, the retreat there at the retreat center. And so I just want to encourage you, if you anticipate and you'd like to come and you hadn't signed up so far, the sheet's still up there after the service, but you can come on out just let us know so that we can make sure we plan for the meals, having a grill out meal on Friday night. And pray for us this weekend that will be a good opportunity. Men's prayer breakfast, October the 19th. So men, remember that. And then next week, there's an extended fall break in the school side. Sunday is a deacons meeting at 3 o'clock, and then there's a missions committee meeting after the evening service. And then also want to mention about the fall festival that is in November. I think it's November the 9th, but there's some material out on the welcome desk for that. We're wanting to pass the word around. This is the first time that the school has done this. It is a fundraiser, so we're collecting money for the school itself, just to go into the general budget, our general fund of the school. And so there's a chili cook-off, so you can register to bring a chili for the competition. And there's also a place for some vendors, if people want to come and put up a table and give some items, be able to shop. It's a good time before Christmas to kind of see. And if you know someone who would maybe be willing to bring be a vendor here for the event. It's a Saturday, 3 to 6, and then they'll have some games for the kids and hayride and a few things that we can be involved in on that Saturday. So looking forward to that. All right, those are our announcements. We're going to sing a couple songs back to back, and then we're going to go to God's Word this evening. We'll save the prayer time to the end tonight.
Let's combine a song of prayer along with a song of God's guidance and care in our lives, and they go neatly together. I Must Tell Jesus. You can remain seated, and then when we go to the second song, This Is My Father's World, we'll finish that standing. Would you stand, please? And we have three good verses of This Is My Father's World and To My Listening Ears.
All right, and let's turn over in our Bibles to Psalm 23. We're going to return where we were last week. Psalm 23, kind of a topical study, and in this topical study, we've stopped in the Psalm 23, David, about the shepherd and the sheep. And so, as we come to this, we'll read it. Now, maybe we could do this. Maybe we could read it together tonight. Most of the time in our scripture reading, we lead that. So oftentimes that we can read together the scripture, Psalm 23. So what I'll do is I'll say the reference, and then we'll start verse 1 and read down to verse 6. And you can read it out loud with me in Psalm 23. So Psalm 23, together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemy. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So we've been studying All We Like Sheep. After one of the sessions last week or the week before, I can't remember, somebody came up to me afterwards and said, Pastor, have you heard about those sheep and goats that do the fainting? You know, they fall over and you've seen. So it sparked my curiosity. I'd seen it before, but it had been years. So I went on YouTube and watched a few funny clips of these creatures that get scared and faint. You heard of the phrase scared stiff? Okay. All right. The condition of these goats is known as myotonia congenita. It's a muscular, temporary muscular rigidity. So it's, you know, the muscles, and they all tighten up and they fall over and roll over on their back. And for a moment, they're stiff. They call this also wooden leg, all right? And in these goats. And then they roll over, and then for, you know, 20 seconds, 15 seconds, some of them a little longer, they get the feeling back, and they turn around and go back. They do this when they're startled, when they're frightened, and they get scared. And so, somebody comes around the corner, and it doesn't hurt them. It seems to be hereditary through certain types of these goats that carry it on. And I've read this week that there are some sheep that have been known to have this wooden leg syndrome, all right, where you get scared and you wouldn't up and then fall over and you get scared. You see, sheep need a shepherd. And sometimes we get afraid because of the things that we go through. And sheep are dependent upon the Lord providentially. Not just physically for the daily bread. All good things come from God. We are dependent on the Lord. Jesus taught his disciples that way. But also spiritually, we are dependent on the Lord to restore us and to lead us in the paths of righteousness, to lead us beside still waters, to cause us to come through the word of God and be corrected. But also sheep are dependent providentially. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Part of the thing about the providence of God, we need to know this, is that in the providence of God, we need to know that the shepherd knows all about our path before we travel it. He knows all about our path, all about our direction. He understands what we're going to face. That includes the good things and the bad things, the difficult things. The Lord, in the book of Jeremiah, I know the thoughts I have towards you, the plans, the purposes that he has. And he wants to do what is well for us, what is good for us. And oftentimes he chooses, because he knows what's better for us, sometimes he chooses to take us into valleys. Now, there are a lot of different landscapes that the shepherd will take his sheep. And as you read through even Psalm 23, you can find a few of those landscapes, can't you? He leads us beside still waters. He causes us to lie down in green pastures. There are, now we read, there are valleys. So there are plains, that would be pasture land, that would be the feeding grounds. There are mountains and hills that you need to go up, and you climb up as a shepherd would take you up to the peaks and the hills. Oftentimes in the winter, they would often take the sheep into certain areas, and they would have to cross distant lands to find food and shelter, and oftentimes maybe even water. But also in this passage, he would take him through
valleys. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. David knew all about the terrain for the sheep. And as the shepherd, he knew what they would go through, that there would be mountains and there would be valleys and there would be caves and there would be hills and there would be plains and there'd be places they could sit down and they could rest, and there'd be places they need to be vigilant and be careful and follow the shepherd and follow the leader. The shepherd knew all about where he was taking his sheep. Oftentimes he had been there many times before the sheep had been there before him. And as the shepherd would take him. And in the imagery of the sheep and the shepherd, sometimes there are places that are difficult to go. And one of these places that David is afraid of, or can be afraid of, is a valley. He addresses this as the valley of the shadow of death. And notices he talks about that he's going to take them through the valley of the shadow of death. In other words, he's not going to take them into it and then that's over. He's actually going to carry them through this valley. It speaks of a shadow as well. Often the valleys were the places where the sun didn't shine as well. So there were often shadows through this valley because of the deep crevices that would take place. I had a few pictures just to draw your attention to in some of these places. This is actually a picture that I took of the city of Jericho in the Jordan Rift. This is about 1,000 feet below sea level, close to the Dead Sea. And notice how dry it is. This is in January, okay, during the rainy season in Israel. And it looks pretty dry. Now, what we're seeing here, and I may bring you back to a picture of this in a couple weeks on a Sunday, because we're actually going through Jericho in the Gospel of Luke. In the foreground, in the closest to us, I believe it is, you can see the mound that's there. That's the old city of Jericho. That would be the tell of Jericho going back to Joshua. In the farther distance, where the houses are and the trees are, that is the new city of Jericho. That would have been the city of Jericho during the time of Jesus. So in Jesus's day, Jericho was already 4,000 years old. All right. 3,000 years old. It was one of the oldest city in the ancient world is Jericho. And so it was already underground under a tell by the time Jesus got there. And very similar today. So there's really two cities of Jericho, and that comes into play when the gospel writers actually tell us, each gospel tells us a couple different things about the two stories in the Gospel of Luke. We'll address that. The reason I bring that out to you is because it is down in this area that there are a lot of sheep and shepherds in this area. Very dry, and the shepherds have to you take the sheep a long distance to find water. And a lot of the Bedouins that continued to use sheep. Interesting, this is this is the main route between Jericho and Jerusalem. All right, you say this is a route? Yeah, this would have been a main highway. If you actually see, there's a couple people walking along this path here. There's a couple people right here taking this path and would go all the way down to the city of Jerusalem. So this is a valley. This is actually what would be considered a dry riverbed, a kilt. This is the Wadi Kilt, which is the main area, drainage area from Jerusalem down to the Dead Sea. And it cuts right through the ground here. And it is dry and arid and pretty dangerous. Okay, here's a pathway. You can see these little areas where he's taking the sheep on these little grades, and they would follow these little paths up and down. And you can actually, it looks like terraces all the way up the hill. And they're ancient paths where these animals, these sheep will cross and go through these valleys. There's even a few, looks like down here, that's probably wandered a little bit astray. I actually took this picture from our bus when we were traveling up the highway out of Jericho into Jerusalem. And so we're traveling, and I looked out and took this picture, two shepherds walking along the side with their sheep along the hill, pretty steep hills and valley edges and ridges that you would see. Now, I bring that up because I want you to understand when David says that you're going to walk through a valley, that the valley to the shepherd and the sheep in that day in this area of Judea, this was a dangerous place. Oftentimes the valleys were hid with caves and places to hide. Bandits would be down there and oftentimes would jump on people and rob them. Jesus told the story of a Samaritan and a gentleman who was traveling down a road. And it was a dangerous road. But it was also dangerous because of flooding. Rains that would come from the hills that you didn't even know it was raining. It wasn't raining here, but the water would rush down, and in a matter of minutes, if you found yourself caught in the middle of that riverbed, you and all your sheep would be washed out. Right? And there's no weather meteorologist to tell you take cover. You had to. There were also wild animals. Wild animals that would roam down in these areas looking for prey and hiding, wolves and bears and even lions during the time of the Old Testament in the first century. Notice as David says here, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Listen to an account that Keller writes in his book. He said, one of the most terrible threats is the sudden chilling storms of sleet, rain, and snow that can sweep down through the valleys from the mountain peaks. If sheep become soaked and chilled with the freezing rain, the exposure can kill them in a very short time. They are thin-skinned creatures, easily susceptible to colds and pneumonia and other respiratory complications. I recall one storm I went through in the foothills of the Rockies in early summer. The morning had been bright and clear. Suddenly around noon, enormous dark, black, forbidding clouds began to sweep down over the hills from the north. A chilling wind accompanied the approaching storm. The sky grew blacker by the hour. Suddenly, in mid-afternoon, long streams of rain and sleet began to sweep across the valley. I ran to take shelter in the clump of stunted, wind-blown spruce. The rain soaked me through as it fell and cooled the whole countryside. The rain turned the sleet, then the coming snow and hail. In a short time, the whole mountain slope in the middle of July was white and frozen. Ominous darkness shrouded the whole scene. The sheep sensed the storm approaching. Perhaps the flock would have perished if they had not raced away to find shelter in the steep cliffs on the edge of the canyon. But in these valleys was where the grass grew best, and it was the route to the high country. Our shepherd knows all of this when he leads us through the valleys with himself. He knows where we can find strength and sustenance and gentle gazing despite even the threat of the disaster that is about us. And so as I think about the shepherd and the sheep being taken through the valley and in this area that is dark and difficult and hard to go, he says, you don't have to fear through that. Why do you not have to fear? Because thou art with me. That's the promise that the Savior gives to the sheep. He gives the presence. The presence of the shepherd takes away the fears. I reminded as we're reading through in our devotions, Joshua and I are reading through 2 Timothy, and we read through the book of 1 Timothy. Now in 2 Timothy, we're reminded of Timothy's timidness and fearfulness as a young man. Paul tells Timothy, while Paul is in a dark place, he's in that prison cell, actually prison hole, in the dungeon underneath the ground. I think I showed you pictures back when I came back from Italy from that prison cell, that hole down there in isolation where there's just a round hole, and they lowered him down in there, and they would lower a bucket for his food and his resource, then bring it back up, and he was left in pitch darkness. He says this to Timothy, God hath not given us the spirit of fear. Do you know the rest of the verse? Well, what kind of spirit has he given us? Of power and of love and of a sound mind. You notice that Paul would say that in a place where, you know, Timothy's enjoying Ephesus. You know, he can go, you know, warm up his food in the microwave. He can go and gather, you know, water when he wants to. He can come and go. He's got some of the resources. And Paul is telling him in a place of darkness that you don't have to be afraid, Timothy. Because in those times, God is with us. And he can, through those valleys, give us power, love, and a sound mind. And I don't know if you've been through some very difficult things. You've been through a valley of the shadow of death. You know what you need during that time? You need strength and you need a sound mind. Because your mind can take you to a lot of difficult, dangerous places. Your mind can be a tool that the devil can creep in with doubts and despair and discouragement. And Job went through something very similar. 1 John 4 and verse 18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. That doesn't mean that the storm is not difficult. It doesn't mean that the rains you don't feel and get cold and you may get pneumonia. It doesn't mean the water and food may be scarce while you're going through that valley. But what it does mean is that through those difficulties, we have the shepherd who is right there with us. That's his providence. And interesting enough, he's been through that valley before. The shepherd knows the path. And he's not wandering around saying, I think we stumbled into a place I've never been before. And hold on a second, let me get my bearings. No, the shepherd knows exactly where he is. I like seeing, in fact, as I've studied through, even reading through this book and Psalm 23 again, and seeing the sheep and the shepherd, I can't separate this from what Moses is doing with the children of Israel as he's taking them out of Egypt. And he brings them to that dead end at the Red Sea, you know, where Egypt is behind him and barreling down in Pharaoh's army. The cliffs are in the valley under there. And then the Red Sea is before them. And they turn around and there's the pillar of fire who's protecting them, between them and the Pharaoh's army. And the people cry out to Moses, "What are you going to do now?" And Moses turns around to God and says, "What are you going to do now?" God says, "Stand still, Moses, and raise your rod." And all through the night, the Lord parted the sea and they walked through on dry ground. The Lord knew what he was going to do. He had been through that path before, and then he would take them through the wilderness. He leads us along. And one of the things we can do is we can trust the promises of God. We can trust the providence of God. That even in the face of suffering and persecution and the valley of the shadow of death, he is with us. And we don't have to be afraid. You ever been afraid? I've been afraid before. In fact, as I was studying this, I don't necessarily mean to share the story necessarily, but Monday afternoon? I was taking a rest. Monday's my day off. And so I was taking a rest and I woke up and I had multiple calls from Pastor Meon. And multiple calls from my wife, right back in the row. I was like, okay. And then my mom calls and says, "You need to talk to your wife right away. Something's happened." And so I immediately hang up and I call Amber. And long story short, Jed hit his head and passed out here in school. And one of the teachers came and brought him limp and out. And didn't know what the situation was, and she had to take him into the ER, and we didn't know what had happened, and did he faint and then fall? Did he fall because of a concussion? And so, you know, here I'm driving from my house to the ER, and she's over there, and they don't know what's wrong, and he's kind of unresponsive in some way, and, you know, you know, your thoughts go through your mind. You've been there before with your children, been there with a spouse. Been there with a loved one, and you pray and you ask the Lord, "Lord, I know you're in control. I know I don't have to fear, but I do fear the unknown. And Lord, you're going to have to give us strength through this to find the answers of what's going on." And there's sometimes it's a moment, and the doctors came back and did some scans and everything, and couldn't find anything. And so after a little bit, he's back and was better, and just a gash on his eye. And we'll follow up on some of that. But I say that because, you know, your day can completely turn around by one valley that you step into. And as long as we're following the shepherd and we're not like Jonah, where we decide to go our own way and we get ourselves in a lot of trouble. But when we're following the shepherd, he leads us and his providence is there and he's taking care of us. And he knows how to protect us. Sheep need protection. I mentioned all the wild animals as he lists in this book. Wolves, lions, birds of prey. I was doing the lesson on the eagles, and I went through a few clips on the eagles, and one of these golden eagles that actually grabbed one of these goats off the mountain peak, and a goat that was twice the size of the eagle, and he's carrying this goat down the mountain peak and just barely getting it, as it's kind of, going down into the valley to take it away. These birds of prey. What about parasites? I didn't realize that the wool and the nose and the eye of these sheep that just shepherd is constantly pulling these parasites out. Harmful foods. I talked to you a week or so ago about certain blooms that the shepherd has to be careful of, that the sheep don't discern what they eat, and so they can eat harmful things. The shepherd has to be out watching. Sheep stealers. Okay? You've got some bandits and some thieves that are out there that want, the economy's not doing well, so they're gonna, take your sheep. Also, self-inflicted wounds. Sheep find a way of hurting themselves and getting themselves stuck in places. I saw a video this week of a cow that had a tree trunk that had come out like this, and the cow got its head stuck in that trunk and had been there, and this farmer was trying to lift this giant cow up to get the head out of difficult. Sheep do those things too, get themselves in a lot of trouble, and they need help. Turn over to John chapter 16, just to draw your attention to a passage that Jesus says to his disciples in John 16. In John 16, in verse 33, he gives his disciples he says here in verse 16, as he talks about the hour that is going to come, and every man is, and you shall leave me alone, and the Father is with me. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have, what's the word? Peace. Sheep need peace, right? And in the world, you shall have, what is the next word? Okay, peace and tribulation to me don't go together. Okay, tribulation is suffering. But be of good, what? What's the word? Cheer. Tribulation and cheer don't go. Peace and cheer seem to me to go together. But tribulation, because I have overcome the world. He gives a promise. You're going to have tribulation, but I offer you peace. And I tell you, I command you, take joy. Find joy. Find cheer in the midst of that tribulation. And what is our cheer based on? Not the tribulation, but the fact that he has overcome the world. He has given the victory. So as you see the valleys, a picture of darkness and danger, there are some difficulties that take place. Sheep need protection. And the shepherd is the one who can heal the wounds. He can restore. In fact, interesting, as I was reading through some of this portion, and I don't have any notes on it necessarily, but it just comes to this point on this. When it says, thou anointest my head with oil, the shepherd would anoint the sheep. He would use oil over the sheep to get the parasites and the flies away. And so it was a healing ointment or oil. So this is not talking as much about anointing someone to be king or anointing someone to be a leader. But this actually, it seems to be a medicinal purpose. And what David is talking about is when I get a wound, when I scrape my knee, when I get parasites in my eyes and on my nose, you anoint my head with oil. You bring healing to me in times of sickness. Okay. The shepherd knows how to heal the wounds. The shepherd knows how to calm our fears. He knows the words to say. The shepherd knows how to protect the sheep. One of the things about the shepherd is that wherever the shepherd goes, he has his equipment with him. And there are several items of equipment that are mentioned in throughout the scripture. We know in the story of David that David carried a sack. He carried a bag. This would have been a waste bag that went around that would often carry food in it. Bread, cheese. But it also could be carried what David put in his sack. He put stones, all right? What were the stones for? His sling, okay? So the shepherd would have a sling, oftentimes to chase away lions and bears or maybe robbers or something like that. He would become very good. So he would have a bag that would carry food in it, oftentimes stones with a sling. But here in the Psalm 23, David mentions two other pieces of equipment that the shepherd would carry. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Two separate pieces of equipment and instrument. The rod that the shepherd would use, it was a 2-foot club. Just a short stick, often had a nubby stop, at the top that they would either wrap leather with and sometimes even put stones in the tip of it to be used as a club. Keller says that he used to watch the young teenage shepherd boys who would practice for hours on end with this club. And they would get to the point where they were able to throw it and hit their objects with it. They would set up stones or they would set up things off to the side. And these little shepherd boys, not only using their sling, but they would use their rod and they would learn to throw it in the right way so that they could hit what they were trying to get. You see, with the rod, the shepherd would use, this is an extension of his arm. This rod would be used as a hand weapon for him. Scripture uses the rod on multiple occasions. Moses is said to have had a rod, and he used that instrument as an extension of God's hand as he held the rod out over the Red Sea. He also used the rod in Pharaoh as he threw the rod down and it budded and different things that God used. It spoke of power, spoke of strength. Ezekiel 20 and verse 37. This is an interesting passage. In fact, if you want to turn over there, we don't often go to Ezekiel. But an interesting metaphor that is used with the rod in Ezekiel 20. In verse 37. And here, he's talking about God's people. And he says here, in verse 36, like I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so I will plead with you, saith the Lord. I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond or the unity of the covenant. I will purge you out from among you the rebels that transgress against me, and I will bring you forth out of the country where they sojourn, and they shall not enter into the land of Israel, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. This is the gathering of God's people. But interesting a phrase here. He says, I will cause you to go under the rod. What is this? This was a terminology that was used, the rod of examination. This was also the rod that was used to count the sheep. Okay, one, two, maybe when he's trying to go to sleep or he's counting his sheep. No, he would count them as they would come in to make sure none of them are missing. And also, the rod was used in a healing fashion oftentimes to examine. The shepherd would use the rod to part the wool in the sheep. So he'd use the rod kind of as an instrument that would peel back if the sheep had a scab or had some parasites or some ticks or something on it. He would use the rod to kind of move around the fur to search around and see if the sheep was okay. So to be passed under the rod is to be brought under the protection of the shepherd and the shepherd's examining eye to look at the sheep. Another passage of scripture that I like, one of my favorite psalms, is Psalm 139. Turn over to Psalm 139. And notice as David writes another psalm at the end of this in verse 23. He says here, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me or test me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me." Notice the directing, the shepherd terminology that is used from David. To search, to try, to lead me in the way of everlasting. So see if there's any wicked way and then lead me in the right way. Proverbs 22, this is a different rod that is spoken of, but it has the same indication here. In Proverbs 22 and verse 15, "Foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child, and it's the rod of correction that will drive it out from him." Keller sees the symbolism of the rod in Psalm 23 as being the word of God that searches and corrects the minds and the hearts of his people. Thy rod and thy staff. A couple notes just on the staff here that comforts. The staff is an instrument that was different than the rod. It oftentimes had a hook at the end, and it was a longer. It was used for the shepherd to lean upon during the late watches of the night. You're not going to lean upon a 2-foot stick, but one that was 6-foot or 5-foot with a curved end that was much stronger, that would use to walk for the shepherd, would walk up and down these hills to keep his balance. Maybe he put his rod in his belt with his sling, and then he would carry his staff with him. And the staff would be different than the rod. The rod could be thrown and was used, often heavy on one end, and could be used apart, and it was easily thrown, where the staff was longer and taller and had a crook on it and a hook. This long stick, or this hook, would be used by the shepherd while oftentimes walking with his sheep. This would speak of the kindness and patience and the care of the shepherd. There were three areas, he writes, of how the staff was used for the shepherd. The shepherd, first of all, would use the staff to bring little lambs closer to their mother when they needed to eat. And they had gotten lost in the crowd and didn't know which one was mama. So the shepherd would use the hook and just the enough and would be able to get the little lamb and bring him to the right mama to find food. How caring that instrument would be. He talks about how this staff would bring and unite, would bring people into fellowship, would bring these sheep to one another so that they could have proper care in unity. The staff was also used to guide the sheep. Interesting, in this picture, he would show, Keller writes, that often shepherds would be seen as using their staff while walking alongside the necks of their sheep. And they would reach out the staff and lean it over the shoulder of the sheep and pull them a little closer and point them in the direction, almost like, he records, almost like that they were holding hands as they walked along the path. The shepherd's extension of his rod to pull the sheep a little closer to him. Oh, you're getting off path. Here, come on over here. Let's hold hands as we go through this difficult road. Just to tell the sheep that here he is, this is direction, here I am, come this way. He also used the staff to get a little lamb who had been stuck in a tight spot, maybe in some bushes that had gotten their horns caught or had gotten caught in a tree, and he could use the hook to bring the sheep and pull them out, tenderly lift them up out of a very difficult place. Those are the three areas by which the staff was used. Keller pictures the staff as the work of the Holy Spirit. The Bible teaches that the Holy Spirit is that comforter who would come alongside his believers and direct them and encourage them in a time, almost like he's putting his arm around them and hand in hand they're going together. An extension of the shepherd. One person said this, "I am more afraid of an army of 100 sheep led by a lion than an army of 100 lions led by a sheep." It's all about the shepherd. Directing the sheep in the right place, the right time, the comfort. Just a couple minutes that we have left, not only do the sheep dependent, but the sheep are also domesticated. These, remember, we're talking about all we like sheep. How are we like sheep? Well, we are to be docile like sheep. We are to have the spirit of tenderness and meekness and a teachable spirit. Being able to be led and sheared. Wherever the shepherd goes, we are willing to go as well. We have a teachable spirit. But sheep are also dependent. They need the shepherd to provide for them physically and spiritually and providentially to guide them. And that's where the hand and the rod and the staff of the shepherd to lead them beside still waters and in the pleasant pastures and in the valley of the shadow of death. To know the shepherd is right there with them. But also sheep are domesticated. Many times in the Jewish culture, the young sheep would sleep in the house with the family. They were treated special to the family compared to the cows and the donkeys and the beasts of burden that were often left aside. But it was the sheep that were often brought along, maybe as some nice pillow, you know. It would be a good place to lay down on. You know, hopefully they were washed and didn't have any parasites. The shepherd did a good job before he brought him into the house to be with his kids. You know, there are a lot of animals that we've attempted to domesticate that aren't meant to be domesticated. You know, there's a difference in something that is tamed and something that is domesticated. When you tame something, you take a specific animal and you can teach them to do certain things. Okay, a horse, you can tame a horse to do certain things. But you wouldn't want to bring a horse into your living room, right? But a domesticated animal is a type of species or subspecies that can come and live alongside humans. There are some creatures that aren't to be, you know, they can maybe be tamed, but they're not meant to be lived next to, such as pythons. Okay? Heard about the story of the woman who was, you know, eat by her own python. And, crawled up in bed with it and said it was doing something weird. It hadn't been eaten. And then talked to the doctor and said, you know, he's sizing you up, okay? And then eventually she ended up being killed. You heard about the bear keeper who was killed by his own bears? You remember that Siegfried and Roy or whatever, the magicians that used those tigers? I remember, I think it was 91 or 93 or whenever I was a teenager. And I remember watching that clip of that tiger at one of the shows that bit him in the neck, drug him across the platform, right? You've heard about the elephants in the circuses that have caused some pretty disastrous situations. I read two stories this last week of a man who had a pet lion in the Czech Republic. When some people came home, he was dead and the lion had eaten him, all right? His body was bleeding out in the family. It was like, what are you thinking, right? These animals aren't truly domesticated. They can be tamed, but they could never take out the wild out of them, all right? In fact, 10 worst animals to keep as pets. I'm not going to read all 10 of them, but you know what number one is on the list of this? Primates. Lemurs, chimpanzees, and baboons all fall into the primate category. They are cute and childlike, but they also act like babies permanently with all the messes and the screaming that's included. The biggest problem with pet monkeys is that they are prone to rampage without warning, as they can possess shocking levels of strength while lacking reason, chances of effectively controlling them are very slim. They also might bite their owners, which is especially scary because they transmit diseases such as hepatitis A and HIV. Okay, so don't have a monkey as a pet. You're never going to take the monkey out of the monkey. All right. I like the way he says it. They act like babies. All the messes and the screams, you're never going to take it away. All of these different things that they rampage. And at any warning, they have this strength and they can tear your ship apart. Right? Remember I told you don't be like bulls? Don't be bull-like. What was the second animal that I told you not to be like last week? Cat. Don't be cat-like. Okay? Here, don't be monkey-like. Are you easy to live with or hard to live with? Are you tame? I mean, you can sit up straight and you can mind your manners, but the whole household never knows when you're going to go into a temper tantrum and when you're going to start flinging stuff, you know? Or are you domesticated? You can live alongside. I think a lesson for us is that maybe we need to be a little bit more like sheep when it comes to living with our family and our friends and the people around us. Our temperament, our personality. Tender, compassionate, meek, but also easy to live with. And sometimes for some of us, there's some rough edges that come out and we act more like monkeys. Some of you act like cats. And probably a lot of us act like bulls. But the scripture gives us as an example as sheep. Sheep are treated special to the families they're taken care of. Psalm 95 and verse 7. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Psalm 103. Know ye not that the Lord, he is God? It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. You see, we are his people. We are his sheep. We are in his pasture. And we are his property. We're not our own, Paul says. We've been bought with a price. Therefore, we are to glorify God in our body and in our spirit, which are his. We are his people and the people of his pasture. And Psalm 23 and verse 6, David closes the psalm and says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And he looks forward to dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. There possibly, in the recognition of this book, there possibly could be, David could be seeing the temple. He could be seeing the sanctuary. Oftentimes the house of the Lord was used as a reference to the temple. But in the sheep and shepherd imagery, when we talked about the house, it was where the shepherd had gathered the sheep. It was back in the sheepfold, in the presence of the shepherd. And David may be just being practical in this by saying, one day we are going to be gathered together with our shepherd in his sheepfold one day, wherever that's going to be. And I believe David took hope that that would be in the afterlife, in the presence. I think he's seeing the heavens of God in the place of God's dwelling. What does it mean to be owned by God? Can I leave you with these 3 points? To be owned by God and to be one of his means that we can go to him in prayer. That means because we are his sheep, when we cry out, when we say, Abba, he is obligated to hear us. See, he doesn't do that for those who are not his. But when we call, he says he will answer and show us great and mighty things. So part of the benefit of being in his sheepfold is that when we pray, he answers. We also, as part of his sheepfold, we are also protected. We are secure in him. John 10:28, scripture says that My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, and neither shall any man snatch or pluck them out of my hand. There's a security that comes in being one of his sheep. And then we also have a home. We have a home in heaven that he's preparing us. The recognition of that is John 14, when he tells his disciples, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I'll come again. And I believe that's the reference of what David is talking about in the house of the Lord. That once this life is over, we have a hope that we will be, as he gathers us through this land and walks us through this valley, we have the promise that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Being part of his sheep means that we have an eternal reward in heaven when we step out of this life and we step into the next. And that's a blessing of being domesticated and being part of his sheepfold. Let's close in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the time we have tonight to be able to conclude the study of the sheep. And Lord, would you teach us to be like sheep? There are areas like sheep that are negative when we roam and we stray and when we've come short of your glory and when we're gullible and we follow the wrong shepherd. But there are some areas that sheep are like, and you bring out those positive traits about the sheep that you just thought were so tender. What a perfect picture for your people between the sheep and its shepherd. And Lord, I pray that you would help us, that we would be sensitive to your rod and your staff as you cleanse us and search us, as you guide us and lead us and often pull us out of some tight spots. And then, Lord, that we know that we are part of your pasture. We're in your sheepfold. And with that comes the security that nothing can happen to us that has not been by your plan and your direction. Nothing that we go through comes into our life by accident that you've not led us through or into. And then, Lord, we have a promise that when it all comes said and done and the end is near for us, we have a home prepared and we have a hope that one day we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you for that hope you gave David. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, God bless you. You are dismissed. Please take some of the prayer bulletin home and use that in prayer. God bless you.